Srimati Nazeem Akhtar Insaf, Minister of State for Education, Government of Rajasthan. The other dignitaries on the dais, and my former minister, Sri Kapil Sibal, who has been here in the morning. Now, all the invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's always difficult to speak after Kapil Sibal ji, because he hardly leaves anything for you. However, in the need for time management, I have written something, so I would want to speak to you on that. In the connected world where we live, it is imperative that education is treated as the only glue that can ensure that the world flourishes. Education itself is the best practice that can happen in one's life. It should teach us humility, benevolence, and a clarity of mind and purpose. I'm reminded of Bhartrhari, the celebrated author, who wrote, Bhavanti namrastaravah phalodgamaihi navambhu abhibhuri lambino dhanaha anudhattaha satpurushaha sabhruddhibhi svabhava evaishaha paropakarinam. Translated, with fruits, trees bend. That is, we need to be humble. With water, clouds hang low. That is, wealthy men maintain humble posture and hence are seen to be benevolent. Education should teach us these values. In my view, it's not unfair to suggest that institutions of higher education have always been created and shaped by the interests of the ruling classes and elites in the society in which they existed or in which they exist. This means they serve to reinforce the economic, political, ideological, and cultural interests of those who create them, fund them, and populate them. We need to take a hard look at this proposition and make education available to everyone who needs it. A truly inclusive system is in everyone's interest. Private, public, and governmental participation has been steadily increasing in the education sector. Forecasts suggest that if current pattern of participation continues, more than 30% of today's school leavers will experience higher education in 10 years from now. A GER of about 18% today would certainly need to be revisited, and the government's endeavor to push it as high as 30% indeed is noble. I wish we maintain a figure of 50% in probably the next 20 odd years. Higher education will shape individual lives and the economy and the society. Such an activity must be the subject of broad consideration. We need to create a knowledge society, since knowledge is pervasive, and it is said about knowledge, again, by Bhartrhari, Jadyam Diyo Harati Sinchati Vach Satyam, Manonnatim Dishati Papam Karoti, Papam Pakaroti, Cheta Prasadayati Dikshut Panyoti Kirti, Satsangati Kathaya Kimna Karoti Pumsam. Translated, lethargy, knowledge removes lethargy of the intellect, invests truth in the speech, enhances the greatness, casts off sin, cleanses mind, and spreads the fame all around. We need to empower the youth, especially today, with education that promotes knowledge, values, and meaningful employment based on the environment that we create. It's a challenge to be able to make a difference to the education expanse today. The times we live are in flux, and recounting any number of best practices of today can at best be a mere perspective. I would like to treat the subject in two stages. Identify what is best, ensure that the produce from the colleges has employment opportunities, and the purpose of education is to ensure progress. The foremost aspects would be the student, the faculty, and the institution. If there were a way to plot these three properties individually and then have a map that plots all the institutes on a single page, it shall enable us to develop a credible system of rating, drawing up a median and then weighted averages for identifying need gaps in colleges that remain below the median will help us improve the performance of the colleges and reduce the base area for the education pyramid. Indeed, there are underlying layers that form the crux of each of the above aspects. The student concerned with the financial, regional, and aspirational mapping. The faculty is concerned with the financial, regional, innovational, and aspirational mapping. And the institution in its ability to create impact in its local vicinity. While there are no quick fixes to what ails, we need to recognize that access to higher education is much better today, though the systems have become more complex and hence more challenging. There cannot be one size fits all formula. And understanding of need gaps when analyzed against the backdrop of the best performing teams of faculty, institution and student will help us deliver a system that is optimized for results. How to ensure that produce from the college hits the ground running to meet employment opportunity is the real problem. The other challenge is the lack of right metrics and planning that do not tie in the produce from the colleges to the available opportunities for the students outside in the commercial world. This leads to lopsided education, imparted unemployment, leading to restive youth. Just as there is a method for forecasting GDP and growth, use of availability around FDI, industrial, farm output, service industry, the output of students and skills can be planned to meet such development of the society midway. A country blessed with great numbers of youth in productive age can also be severely undercut if they are not in the mainstream. An example would suffice the seriousness of this statement. Over 50% of youth fail between 10th, 11th and 12th grade and probably out of education scene forever after that. They surely must be contributing to the growth of the country in some way, in as much as contributing to the muck that is available today. An out-of-box approach and possible best practices could be to allow them to pass the grade with minimal intervention. The government's move to exempt examinations is truly out of box, critics apart, and worth a million in the bullion market. We need more of that. Assuming an incremental value addition happens to the entropy of the universe, it is still worth it apart from the collateral advantage of higher GER and overall growth in economics brought about by an exalted youth. We need not have delusions of our education systems on what we need to do and what we have done in the past of managing our education systems. As Sant Kabir said, Maya Maya sab kahe, Maya lakhe na koe, jo man se na utare, Maya kahiye soe. Everyone talks about delusion. No one understands what it is. The one that wraps the mind should be defined as delusion. We need to come out of that. For real progress, we need to lead our education paradigm upfront, inspired to conceive beyond the norms into new paradigms of learning and so on. One great incongruity in our system has been development of an organized sector of barely 10%, when the developed world over, the figure is in the excess of 80%, and a total neglect of the so-called unorganized sector, whose development in reality has unheard potential for many of the ills of this country. Hence, skill development, both in the organized and the unorganized sector, and training as an education imperative is an extremely important activity for the growing economy such as ours. A scheme for vocational education where a student can learn competency-based skills along with general education at various certificate levels initiated early in the school going all the way up to diploma or a graduate level is probably the way to go. With a bachelor's in vocational now duly constituted, expected to play catalyst to an otherwise saturated system. A student in this mode is expected to study for a diploma or a degree in vocational education along with acquiring skills. The most important feature of the framework created by AICTE is that a student could also avail of multi-point entry and exit between formal and vocational education and the job markets, setting up community colleges, either new or in the existing polytechnics, needs to be pushed aggressively so that competency-based skills with basic life skills is imparted to enhance the employment potential of our youth. Private, public, and governmental participation has been steadily increasing in the education sector. Forecasts suggest that if current patterns of participation continue, more than 30% of today's school leavers will experience higher education in 10 years from now. Higher education will shape individuals' lives in that sense, and moving to a truly egalitarian society that provides education for all is something that we all should aspire for. We also need to realize that our youth coming from the kind of financial means that they have would need to be sustained on some minimal financial incentive to pursue skills for employment, and hence we need credible financial models to sustain education for youth. Let me suggest a model for our planners. Out of more than 11,500 institutions that we have in the technical education space, even if we were to select 5,000 under the community college framework as a subset of NVQF for the conduct of VE programs, the opportunities indeed are massive. If 100 students are trained in competency-based skills, 50 a batch thrice a week, we would have a huge force and an increase of 5.3 points in GER. If each of these students, assumed poor, is provided 50 rupees a day to take care of travel and food for the period of conduct of the programs, the grant required is small and the benefits massive. We need to inspire, achieve, and engage our youth, wean them away from divisive forces, build them into a formidable force to pitchfork the economy, to be positioned at a higher plane, and of course create a win-win for everyone, so that again, like Sant Kabir said, Kala Nala Neel Hoye, Kala Nala Heen Jal, so fir Pani Hoye, Jo Pani Moti Bhaya, so fir Neer Na Hoye. Ice becomes water in the course of time. The water that has become a pearl will never again become water. We need to convert all our youth into pearls. Best practices in education is national at best, though specifics can always be defined. Anything that adds to overall well-being and acts as a force multiplier for economy is the best practice, be it in education, medicine, economics, or any other. Thank you.